puedo evitar. En el mar sería arena, como sacudí el jibe, a chan chan le daba pena.
Thank you.
Ganz herzlichen Dank an die Musiker, sehr verehrte Frau Bundesministerin, liebe Frau Stark-Watzinger, sehr geehrter Herr Staatsminister, lieber Herr Blume, sehr geehrte liebe Frau Ministerin Schüle, Presidents and Heads of Research Councils, it's such a pleasure to have you here. Meine sehr verehrten Damen und Herren, werte Vertreterinnen und Vertreter von Politik und Mitgliedseinrichtungen, liebe Kolleginnen und Kollegen, verehrte Gäste. Ich freue mich wirklich sehr, Sie alle sehr, sehr herzlich zu diesem Festakt im Rahmen der Jahresversammlung der DFG willkommen zu heißen. Und schon auf dem Weg, einige von Ihnen, als Sie so auf dem Weg waren, sagten, das schwankt ja hier ganz schön. Also schon auf Ihrem Weg in die Orangerie der Potsdamer Biosphäre konnten Sie aus luftiger Höhe einen ersten Blick auf die tropische Flora und Fauna werfen. Mit seinen beschwingten Rhythmen hat das Trio La Vera das Lebensgefühl der Tropen zu Beginn, finde ich, auch musikalisch schon zum Ausdruck gebracht. Lassen Sie mich Ihnen, werte Musiker, sehr, sehr herzlich danken, dass Sie uns beim Festakt und auch beim anschließenden Empfang, das ist ja mindestens genauso wichtig, muss man sagen, in dieser Atmosphäre mit Ihren Klängen aufblühen lassen. Ich freue mich sehr, dass wir alle uns dieses Jahr in dieser grünen Oase versammeln. Mein ganz besonderer Dank gilt dabei der Universität Potsdam und insbesondere natürlich Ihnen, geschätzter Herr Präsident, lieber Herr Günther, für die Einladung, unsere diesjährige Jahresversammlung hier im schönen Potsdam durchführen zu können. Auch Sie, werter Herr Oberbürgermeister Schubert, seien sehr, sehr herzlich bedankt. Dieses Jahr ist auch für die Wissenschaft bedeutsam, denn mit dem 75. Jubiläum unseres Grundgesetzes, das seit bald 35 Jahren in ganz Deutschland gilt, feiern wir auch das Grundrecht der Wissenschaftsfreiheit. Sie garantiert der Wissenschaft einen offenen Erkenntnisprozess, frei von gesellschaftlichen Nützlichkeits- und politischen Zweckmäßigkeitsvorstellungen. Dafür sind wir dankbar, denn die Vielfalt der in Freiheit erzielten Erkenntnisse und Innovationen sind wirklich das Kapital für unsere Zukunft. Und genau deshalb ist sie für die Wettbewerbsfähigkeit unseres Wissenschafts- und Wirtschaftsstandorts ebenso wie für unsere Gesellschaft und Demokratie so wertvoll. Exzellente, innovative Wissenschaft bedarf dieser Freiheit ebenso wie der Unterstützung durch verlässliche politische Partnerinnen und Partner. Die DFG und die erkenntnisgeleitete Spitzenforschung in Deutschland können in dieser Hinsicht seit langem vertrauensvoll auf die Unterstützung ihrer Zuwendungsgeber bauen. Stellvertretend für die Unterstützung des Bundes möchte ich Ihnen, liebe Frau Bundesministerin Stark-Watzinger, und stellvertretend für die Länder, Ihnen, lieber Herr Staatsminister Blume, sehr, sehr herzlich danken. Die erfolgreiche Koordinierung der Wissenschaftspolitiken der Länder und die Abstimmungen mit dem Bund in der GWK sind für die Forschung in Deutschland von unschätzbarer Bedeutung. Ihrer beider Anwesenheit als aktuelle Doppelspitze der GWK und Ihre Bereitschaft, das Wort an uns zu richten, ehrt und freut uns sehr. Neben Ihnen als VertreterInnen der deutschen Politik beehren uns heute auch die Leitungen zweier europäischer Forschungsförderorganisationen mit ihrer Anwesenheit. Auf der Bühne der Jahresversammlung einer nationalen Förderorganisation ist dies ein außerordentlicher Grund zur Freude, besonders für die DFG. Vor allem aber ist es ein starkes Signal für die enge Partnerschaft unserer Organisationen in Europa. Daher freue ich mich sehr, mit Krzysztof Wierzbiak vom Nationalen Wissenschaftszentrum Polen, NCN, und Dame Ottolin Leiser von UKRI, zwei ausgewiesene ExpertInnen der europäischen Forschungszusammenarbeit, begrüßen zu dürfen. Als Forschungsförderer stehen unsere Organisationen wirklich in tiefer Verbundenheit, das darf man sagen. etwa durch gemeinsame Ausschreibungen über WEAVE oder unsere Zusammenarbeit im Global Research Council und Science Europe. Auch persönlich kennen wir uns von vielen Sitzungen und haben uns zuletzt vor kurzem, vor 2 Wochen, in Interlaken und in Warschau getroffen. Auf dem Podium werden wir gemeinsam Fragen der europäischen Forschungszusammenarbeit erörtern. Vielen herzlichen Dank, dass Sie für diesen gemeinsamen Austausch den weiten Weg nach Potsdam gekommen sind. Ganz besonders begrüßen möchte ich auch den Präsidenten der Hochschulrektorenkonferenz, Walter Rosenthal. Lieber Walter, ich danke dir ganz herzlich, dass du dich bereit erklärt hast, die Sicht der deutschen Hochschulen auf die europäische Zusammenarbeit dann in die Diskussion einzubringen. Außerdem begrüße ich sehr herzlich die Vertreterinnen und Vertreter unserer Mitgliedseinrichtungen. Wir haben ja in den letzten Tagen schon viel gemeinsam gesessen und viel gemeinsam debattiert, was ich immer als überaus bereichernd empfinde. Meine Damen und Herren, vielen Dank für Ihre Anwesenheit, ganz herzlichen Dank für Ihr Engagement für die freie, erkenntnisgeleitete Forschung in den Universitäten, Hochschulen und Forschungseinrichtungen dieses Landes. Und Ihnen allen wünsche ich viel, viel Vergnügen heute Abend, denn wir wollen ja auch ein bisschen feiern. Ja, meine Damen und Herren, und damit möchte ich gerne das Wort an Frau Bundesministerin Stark-Watzinger übergeben und anschließend wird Herr Staatsminister Blume sein Grußwort sprechen.
Sehr geehrte Frau Professor Becker, sehr geehrter Herr Staatsminister Blume, Vertreterinnen und Vertreter der Wissenschaft, der Politik, der Gesellschaft. Ich freue mich sehr, hier heute bei Ihnen zu sein. Florence Gaub, eine Militärexpertin, die sich aber auch sehr stark mit der Zukunft befasst, sagte kürzlich in einem Interview zu ihrem Buch, das Zukunft heißt: Ich möchte in 50 Jahren leben. So einen Satz hört man heute nicht oft, weil ja doch sehr viel Unsicherheit, sehr viel Angst auch in unserer Gesellschaft ist mit Blick auf die Zukunft vor dem Hintergrund von Krisen. Aber was wir heute erleben dürfen und was für das die DFG als Teil unseres wunderbaren Wissenschaftssystems steht, ist eben immer wieder diese Zukunftsperspektiven geben, diese Licht, das Licht für die Zukunft geben und den Optimismus für die Zukunft geben. Und genau deshalb braucht unsere freie Gesellschaft das, was Sie eben angesprochen haben, Frau Professor Becker, die freie Wissenschaft. Der Fortschritt und die Zukunft, sie hängen von ihr ab. Das zeigen aktuelle Debatten, die wir global führen. Und deswegen möchte ich zu Beginn dieses Abends noch mal ganz klar sagen, die Deutsche Forschungsgemeinschaft, die DFG, sie ist ein Fels in der Brandung, besonders in diesen Zeiten. 5 Minuten habe ich, deswegen 5 ganz kurze Schlaglichter, die ich heute mitgebracht habe. Und ich möchte mit dem ersten beginnen, liebe Frau Professor Becker, ich musste in den letzten Wochen oft an Ihre Rede denken, die Sie im Rahmen der Jahresversammlung 2022 gehalten haben. Und ich zitiere, es ging damals um den Beginn des Ukraine-Kriegs: Der Krieg bedroht nicht nur die Werte eines freien Europas, sondern auch die einer freien Wissenschaft. Autonomie und Selbstbestimmung sind politische, aber ebenso wissenschaftliche Werte. Und ich möchte Ihnen und all Ihren Kolleginnen und Kollegen danken für die Solidarität, die Sie gegenüber der Ukraine zeigen, für die klare Positionierung auch gegen Autokratien, die Krieg führen, auch unter Inkaufnahme schmerzlicher Einbußen im wissenschaftlichen Austausch. Das sehen wir. Sie setzen sich ein für den Erhalt der Wissenschaft, auch den Wiederaufbau und die Unterstützung der Ukraine auf dem Weg in den europäischen Forschungsraum. Denn Bildung und Forschung, sie sind die Grundlage von allem in jedem Land und natürlich auch entscheidend für eine wirtschaftlich starke und souveräne Ukraine. Das Ziel, das Zitat hat aber nicht nur mit Blick auf den Krieg in der Ukraine sich bewahrheitet, sondern auch mit Blick auf Nahost. Ich danke Ihnen und der Allianz der Wissenschaft sehr für Ihre klare Positionierung zu den, oder besser gesagt gegen die Boykottbestrebung gegenüber den Wissenschaftlerinnen und Wissenschaftlern in Israel. Zu Recht beschreiben Sie solche Bestrebungen in Ihrer Stellungnahme als diskriminierend und verfehlt, denn ich zitiere: die israelischen Hochschulen und Wissenschaftseinrichtungen, sie sind tragende Säule der freiheitlich-demokratischen Gesellschaft Israels. Sie sind gerade in Zeiten intensiver Diskussionen innerhalb Israels über den Friedensprozess im Nahen Osten als Räume für einen freien und offenen Diskurs zu stärken. Und ich komme gerade aus Israel und ich kann Ihnen sagen, die Wissenschaftlerinnen und Wissenschaftler, ob in der Early Career Phase oder die Präsidentinnen und Präsidenten von großen Einrichtungen dort, sie alle sehen Sie hier als Leuchtturm, als Fels in der Brandung in schwierigen Zeiten. Herzlichen Dank dafür. Mein zweiter Punkt, der bleibt bei Verantwortung, die Sie übernehmen. Und Ihnen muss ich das natürlich nicht sagen, alle, die hier im Raum sitzen. Die Deutsche Forschungsgemeinschaft ist die Selbstverwaltungsorganisation der Wissenschaft, Selbstverwaltungsorganisation. Sie ist damit ein elementarer Teil dessen, was uns so stark macht, wir haben schon gesagt, der Wissenschaftsfreiheit. Und aus gegebenem Anlass betone ich noch einmal, die Förderung von Wissenschaft, sie war, sie ist und sie wird, sie muss immer auf wissenschaftsgeleiteten Verfahren beruhen und darf niemals von politischer Weltanschauung abhängig sein, egal aus welcher Richtung. Und die DFG ist hier ebenfalls ein Fels in der Brandung in all diesen Diskussionen. Sie haben sich schon in ihren 10 Thesen zur Wissenschaftsfreiheit 2019 klar positioniert. Und auch hier muss man immer wieder betonen, die Wissenschaft und die wissenschaftliche Zusammenarbeit, sie leben von der Freiheit, unser wertvollstes Gut, frei forschen, frei Entscheidungen treffen, frei Schlussfolgerungen ziehen, all das macht kreative Forschung überhaupt erst möglich. Ich komme zu meinem dritten Punkt. Ich werde ganz bestimmt nicht wagen, in einem Grußwort den Begriff Exzellenz zu definieren, in seiner Breite, in seiner Tiefe. Wissenschaftliche Exzellenz aber als Türöffner, als Leuchtturm für neue Wissensräume, auch für ganz neue Bereiche, die erarbeitet werden, für unser Verstehen als Handwerk, als intellektuell-konzeptionelle Leistung mit ganz bestimmten Gelingensbedingungen und natürlich auch die Menschen, die dahinter stehen. Es ist ein Wert an sich, das haben Sie eben schon gesagt. Aber sie macht uns auch wirtschaftlich stark, gerade auch diese freie Grundlagenforschung. Professor Kramer hat es jüngst in einem Vortrag an der Universität Graz herausgearbeitet. Über 40% der ERC-Projekte, die als Grundlagenforschung im 7. Rahmenprogramm und in der ersten Hälfte des 8. Rahmenprogramms gefördert wurden, führten zu Forschungsergebnissen, die später in Patenten zitiert wurden. Denn auch hier steckt dieses Potenzial der Zukunft. Und natürlich, das sehen wir ja in diesen Tagen, wie der britische Philosoph Francis Bacon schon im 16. Jahrhundert sagte, Wissen ist Macht. Sie unterstützen den Forschungsstandort Deutschland, indem sie auch hier wieder als Fels in der Brandung die Exzellenzstrategie tragen, die wir haben, die viele Arbeit, die in dieser Exzellenzstrategie steckt. Und deswegen auch hier herzlichen Dank. Sie sind für uns auch eine Hüterin der Exzellenz, der Zukunftsfähigkeit des Wissenschaftsstandorts Deutschland. Mein vierter Punkt führt noch einmal zu den geopolitischen Spannungen, die auch vor der Wissenschaft keinen Halt machen. Und Forschungssicherheit bekommt mehr Bedeutung jeden Tag. Aber meistens denken wir in der Kategorie Abwehr. Wir müssen viel früher beginnen. Wir müssen beginnen, indem das Erste, was wir tun müssen, ist selber stark zu sein, eine starke, lebendige Wissenschaft haben. Und deswegen ist das ein Gut, das wir haben in der DFG und unserer Wissenschaft, aber auch, weil Sie die Stärkung der Zusammenarbeit mit Wertepartnern weltweit, aber auch ganz besonders mit Partnern in der EU vorantreiben. Die EU ist nämlich mehr als ein Wirtschaftsraum und deswegen ist ihr Panel heute Stronger Together mit den National Funding Agencies in Europe. Es könnte nicht aktueller sein, weil es eben zur DNA der Wissenschaft gehört, international zusammenarbeiten. Alles andere wäre ein Verlust. Mein fünfter und letzter und kürzer Punkt ist, wir stehen ja derzeit an großen, interessanten technologischen Schwellen, die vor uns liegen. Denken wir an Quantenphysik, künstliche Intelligenz, Zukunftsenergien, Biotechnologie und was es noch alles gibt. Aber natürlich auch die Frage, wie hält unsere Gesellschaft zusammen, wie verstehen wir die Geschichte, was können wir daraus lernen? Also alles große Zukunftsfragen und eines ist ganz klar, diese Fragen werden wir nur mit der Wissenschaft und durch die Wissenschaft bewältigen und werden die Antworten finden. Und deswegen mein fünfter Punkt, die Wissenschaft, sie bestimmt das Tempo des Fortschritts und dafür sind wir Ihnen sehr dankbar. Und es gibt ganz viele Politiker und Menschen, denen man einen Satz zugeschrieben hat, der nämlich heißt, bisher wurden in Deutschland mehr Zeit durch Grußworte verloren gegangen als durch Streiks. Das nehme ich jetzt mal sehr ernst heute. Deswegen möchte ich zum Schluss nur noch eins sagen und mein Grußwort schließen. Ich danke Ihnen sehr. Für mich steht es fest, gäbe es die DFG nicht, man müsste sie erfinden. Sie sind der Fels in der Brandung in diesen Tagen. Herzlichen Dank.
Meine sehr geehrten Damen und Herren, liebe Frau Präsidentin Becker, liebe Frau Bundesministerin, liebe Kollegin Schüle und liebe Vertreterinnen und Vertreter der Wissenschaftscommunity hier in Deutschland. Ich darf Sie alle ganz herzlich, auch quasi länderseitig hier begrüßen. Ich freue mich sehr, dass wir Frau Becker gemeinsam zu dieser ja doch auch Feierstunde zusammenkommen können. Ich habe mich zunächst gefragt, die Wahl des Ortes, Tropenparadies, in das Sie uns hier einladen, was wollen Sie uns damit sagen? Und ich gehe davon aus, irgendjemand wird sich schon was dabei gedacht haben. Sind wir reif für die Insel? Ist das alles irgendwie ein Affenzirkus, aber ein paar Affen am Herweg gesehen? Oder ist die Botschaft einfach, bei der DFG ist immer gutes Wetter? Ich vermute jetzt einfach mal Letzteres, weil Sie natürlich auch wissen, dass Sie sich, wenn es hart auf hart kommt, dann schon auf die Politik verlassen können. Also zunächst mal Feierstunde, und das will ich vorneweg sagen, die Deutsche Forschungsgemeinschaft, die Ministerin hat es gerade schon formuliert, man müsste sie erfinden, wenn es sie nicht schon gäbe. Warum ist das so? Weil es unsere neutrale und vor allem die international sichtbare Visitenkarte des Wissenschaftsstandorts Deutschland ist in Europa, ehrlicherweise auch in der ganzen Welt. Mehr noch, es ist auch die besonnene Stimme unsere Wissenschaftsrepublik, die an ganz vielen Stellen immer wieder gebraucht wird. Und ich danke Ihnen sehr, dass Sie vorangehen bei Themen, die auch nicht einfach sind. Sie haben sich positioniert gegen Antisemitismus, wir haben es gerade schon gehört. Sie haben zu internationalen Dingen Stellung genommen, sehr deutlich Stellung genommen und das in der angemessenen Balance, das ist sehr wichtig. Und das alles führt dazu, dass diese Organisation, meine Damen und Herren, höchste Reputation in Deutschland und darüber hinaus genießt. Ich kann Ihnen das nur an einem Beispiel persönlich schildern. Als wir, Frau Becker, in Bonn waren anlässlich der Sitzung der Exzellenzkommission. Also es gibt wenige Orte, wo ein gestandener Minister oder gestandene Ministerin dann doch mit relativ weichen Knien reingeht. Und es war irgendwie so eine Versammlung, weil du weißt, klar, es geht um viel, aber du weißt vor allem, da sitzt eine unglaublich geballte Expertise und Exzellenz vertreten eben durch und in der Deutschen Forschungsgemeinschaft. Ich darf Ihnen einfach herzliches Dankeschön sagen für die großartige Arbeit in den letzten Jahren, in der letzten Zeit und beständig für den Wissenschaftsstandort Deutschland. Herzliches Dankeschön. Da meine Redezeit nicht länger ist und ich schon Zeit verplempert habe, mit den Punkten, die ich unbedingt lobend erwähnen sollte, meine Damen und Herren, Spaß, also habe ich freiwillig gemacht, möchte ich Ihnen drei Gedanken aber mit auf den Weg geben. Das erste Stichwort ist Exzellenz. Klar, was soll es auch anders sein, Frau Bundesministerin, Sie hatten das auch in Ihrer Stichwortliste. Wenn man über die DFG spricht, dann ist Exzellenz eines der entscheidenden Stichworte. Warum? Ich bin der festen Auffassung, Deutschland lebt davon, dass wir auf Exzellenz setzen, wenn es um Wissenschaft und Forschung geht. Es ist unser Differenzierungsmerkmal in der Welt. Wenn wir es nicht exzellent machen würden, dann wären wir halt mittelmäßig. Und Mittelmäßigkeit, die gibt es erstens gratis in der Regel. Und zweitens reicht es wahrscheinlich nicht aus, um die Dinge auszugleichen, wo wir halt dann im Wettbewerb uns doch schwer tun, insbesondere auf Seiten der Preise. Ich habe diese Exzellenz aber nur, wenn ich radikal auf Wissenschaftsgeleitetheit setze. Und dafür, dass sie sich in völliger Unbestechlichkeit ergehen und sich maximal neutral, aber immer eben erkenntnis- und wissenschaftsgeleitet aufstellen, darf ich Ihnen einfach Danke sagen. Und ich halte es auch für wichtig, bei allen Wünschen, die immer wieder herangetragen werden. Es ist ja noch keine Woche her, dass auch der Eindruck erweckt wurde, dass in Deutschland jetzt gezielt Strukturpolitik mit Wissenschaftspolitik gemacht werden soll. Langfristig sind Investitionen in Wissenschaft, Innovation immer goldrichtig. Aber es sollte nie der Eindruck entstehen, dass das Brä von politischen Wünschen am Ende die Oberhand gewinnt bei der Frage, wo was passiert. 91b ist deswegen auch so ein gutes Verfahren, weil es nie Zweifel daran gibt, dass diese Entscheidungen immer wissenschaftsgeleitet getroffen sind und das soll auch so bleiben. Das Zweite, meine Damen und Herren, der Einsatz, der ist am Ende entscheidend. Und ich habe irgendwie das Gefühl, wahrscheinlich braucht es noch mehr Einsatz für das, was die DFG vertritt und wofür sie steht. Wir brauchen mehr Geld, da kann es überhaupt keinen Zweifel geben. Die Aussage ist immer richtig und in Zeiten von knappen Kassen bei Bund und Ländern umso anspruchsvoller. Und trotzdem müssen wir bei den anstehenden Diskussionen schauen, dass wir die Punkte richtig setzen. Und so eine Diskussion für Feinschmecker könnte die Diskussion um die Programmpauschalen sein, liebe Kollegin Schüle. Ich kann nur sagen, ich würde es als schwieriges Signal erachten, wenn der Eindruck entstünde, dass künftige Programmpauschale aus dem DFG-Etat irgendwie herausgeschnitten werden müsste aus dem Forschungsetat. Da müssen wir gemeinsam schauen, wie wir da andere Wege finden. Aber es ist nicht nur... Aber es ist jetzt nicht nur der einfache Ruf nach mehr Geld, der, wie gesagt, immer richtig ist. Ist auch eine Frage von Prioritätensetzung. Es ist auch der Wunsch nach mehr gemeinsam. Und das ist etwas, was ich in den letzten 2,5 Jahren vielfach feststellen durfte. Die Zeiten, wo wir so schwimmen in Ressourcen, dass jeder seins machen kann. Mein Lehrstuhl, meine Uni, mein Institut, mein Land. Die Zeiten sind irgendwie ein Stück weit vorbei. Und deswegen finde ich das Thema der diesjährigen Versammlung hier so richtig und wichtig, dass man mehr gemeinschaftlich denkt, auch überlegt, wie wir in Europa die Kräfte bündeln können. Wir haben ehrlicherweise in vielen Fällen nur dann eine Chance, wenn wir es gemeinsam machen. Und dazu ist auch notwendig, dass ehrlicherweise auch die verschiedenen Akteure, Universitäten wie außeruniversitäre Einrichtungen, auch überlegen, welche Rolle habe ich in diesem System ganz dezidiert. Und der dritte und letzte Punkt, ganz kurz, aber vielleicht auch wichtig. Ich habe in den letzten Jahren viele Wissenschaftlerinnen und Wissenschaftler, absolute Koryphäen getroffen. Und dann gab es immer einen Punkt in den Gesprächen, wo du gemerkt hast, da trübt sich jetzt so der Blick ein bisschen ein. Und das war, wenn sie geklagt haben, wie die Bürokratie, die Mühsal der Ebene auch in der Wissenschaft zuschlägt. Und ich glaube, so eine Entbürokratisierungsoffensive auch in diesem Bereich täte uns tatsächlich mal allen gut. Und das ist jetzt natürlich leicht formuliert und schwierig umgesetzt. Aber zu sagen, man sorgt für etwas mehr Fokus und es braucht vielleicht nicht 18.000, habe ich gerade vorhin nochmal gehört, 18.000 Anträge, die jährlich von der DFG begutachtet werden müssen, müssen ja vielleicht nicht 18.000 sein. Vielleicht kriegen wir es hin, dass wir irgendwie ein paar größere Töpfe hinstellen und am Ende sagen, vielleicht kommt auch die Zeit, wo wir mehr an der Grundfinanzierung insgesamt machen müssen, um uns nicht zu Tode zu siegen in einzelnen Wettbewerben, wo am Ende die manche sich schon die Frage stellen, ob die Bürokratie, die damit verbunden ist, den Aufwand überhaupt noch rechtfertigt. Meine Damen und Herren, mein kluger Satz zum Schluss, Wissenschaft, die lebt von Voraussetzungen, die sie selbst nicht garantieren kann. Das klingt so ein bisschen nach Böckenförde, aber es ist auch in diesen Tagen wichtig zu betonen und auch richtig. Was will ich damit sagen? Sie sind natürlich verdammt darauf angewiesen, dass Sie in der Politik Rückhalt finden für das, was Sie tun und auch die Verlässlichkeit und das Vertrauen bei uns finden, dass wir auf Sie setzen. Und das darf ich Ihnen einfach signalisieren, insbesondere im Vertrauen darauf, dass wir schon recht bald zusammenkommen, nämlich am 12. Juli, liebe Frau Bundesministerin, gemeinsam in der gemeinsamen Wissenschaftskonferenz, wo alle großen Forschungsorganisationen der Republik eingeladen sind, um in die zweite Halbzeit des PFI zu gehen. Und wenn es einen besseren Beweis dafür gäbe, dass wir für Vertrauen und Verlässlichkeit in Deutschland stehen können, dann ist es dieser PFI, der ist eine Erfolgsgeschichte. Wir wollen die gemeinsam verlängern und ich verspreche, Sie dürfen sich auf uns verlassen. Alles Gute.
Ja, sehr verehrte Frau Bundesministerin, sehr geehrter Herr Staatsminister, haben Sie vielen Dank für Ihre Worte, für Ihre Offenheit, auch dafür, dass Sie beide sich all den aktuellen Herausforderungen, die wir haben in diesem Land, und auch den Diskussionen stellen, dass Sie gekommen sind, dass Sie hier sind, dass Sie bei uns sind. Weil ich denke, das sind wirklich ganz, ganz, ganz wichtige und hervorragende Signale. Vielen Dank auch für Ihre Anerkennung, die Sie beide zum Ausdruck gebracht haben. Wir freuen uns darüber wirklich sehr. Und ich gebe diese Anerkennung sehr, sehr gerne mit ganzem Herzen wirklich weiter an all die Wissenschaftlerinnen und Wissenschaftler, die Mitglieder all unserer Gremien, die sich so sehr engagieren. Das Wort Selbstverwaltungsorganisation ist ja irgendwie ziemlich sperrig. Ich habe es noch nie so wirklich gemocht, aber wenn man darüber nachdenkt, was es bedeutet, dann ist es irgendwo richtig gut. Und dafür, sowie für die exzellente Wissenschaft, wird die DFG auch in den kommenden Jahren stehen. Ja, Sie haben es beide erwähnt, Kooperation und Vertrauen sind auch für die bi- und multilaterale Zusammenarbeit natürlich essentiell in der Forschung, in Deutschland, in Europa und natürlich auch in der ganzen Welt. Und genau darüber möchten wir jetzt ein wenig diskutieren. Und ich freue mich sehr, an dieser Stelle Herrn Krauter begrüßen zu dürfen, der uns als Moderator nun durch den weiteren Abend begleiten wird. Herr Krauter.
Vielen Dank, Frau Professor Becker. Ich freue mich sehr, heute Abend hier sein zu dürfen bei dieser Festveranstaltung der Deutschen Forschungsgemeinschaft und zum Warmlaufen für Phase 2 dieses Abends, wobei Warmlaufen vielleicht gar nicht mehr erforderlich ist durch den Weg, den wir hierher gegangen sind. Zum Warmlaufen für Phase 2 dieses Abends, wo wir ja quasi die internationale Brille auf die nationale Forschungsförderung mal werfen wollen, den Fokus drauf werfen, schalten wir jetzt direkt um auf Englisch. Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and a very warm welcome. It's my pleasure to be the host of the panel discussion we are about to have in a couple of minutes. And the title has already been mentioned, Stronger Together, National Research Funding Agencies in Europe. And I'm really looking forward to talking to four outstanding experts whose names have already been mentioned. One of them will, of course, be Professor Katja Becker, the president of the German Research Foundation. And before I introduce the three other persons, whose names have already been mentioned as well, let's briefly look back. Let's remember where we currently stand, and let's see what the challenges are we facing. The European Research Area era has been founded or established 24 years ago, in the year 2000, and I'm really confident that all of us in here tonight would agree that it's basically been an amazing success story. Because ERA has really helped to boost international cooperation in many ways in the field of research and innovation. And it has really fostered thousands of collaborations among scientists, universities, and research organizations. As science has always been an international endeavor, these multiple cross-border cooperations within Europe where human capital and knowledge are freely exchanged are really crucial for economic development and also for our social development, as the minister already has mentioned as well. The flip side of this is we all know that we need to do even better in the future. If you want to secure our scientific and technological knowledge base, if you want to keep pace with competitors like the USA and China, business as usual probably won't be sufficient. If Europe wants to continue playing a vital role in the field of research and innovation, we will probably need even more cooperation and joint activities. So how could we do this? How could we do better? How could we harvest the full potential of the European research area? What can national research funding agencies learn from each other? And how could they join their forces even more effectively in the future to make the European research area even more attractive and productive? Interesting questions. We tried to work out answers during the panel discussion now, and as a kickstart for that, we'll now have a 10-minute impulse talk by Professor Katja Becker, the president of the DFG, where she will share her ideas on how to promote scientific cooperation in Europe with us. Professor Becker, we're curious. The stage is yours.
Yeah, sorry, now you have to listen to me again, but somehow this is how we built this evening. So, yeah, ladies and gentlemen, excellencies, distinguished guests, the European research area is a fact. And overcoming borders through cooperation is one of its core values. When the world's brightest minds work together, able to choose their research topics and partners as freely as possible, excellent knowledge-driven research transcends national borders by its very nature. And it does so all the more effectively, the more favorable the framework conditions are. For this reason, the DFG is striving for a European research area, ERA for short, in which collaborations between researchers in Germany and their partners in Europe can be funded as efficiently and as flexibly as possible. Our new Europe strategy sets out 10 goals, with the expansion of bilateral and multilateral cooperation in the era as a key element. I'm therefore delighted that our three distinguished panelists will be joining us in a moment to discuss aspects of this cooperation. From the DFG's perspective, the era is determined by three factors: strong national research systems, multilateral cooperation, and EU funding programs. It is the effective and diversified interaction of these three factors that ensures a highly innovative and globally competitive era. The DFG is committed to advancing the era by pursuing three principles. Firstly, to promote knowledge-driven research of the highest quality in a fair and science-led competition. Secondly, to strategically support emerging fields of research where necessary. And thirdly, to shape the best possible framework conditions. We seek to contribute to a strong and dynamic era in which researchers can cooperate with partners in Europe at any time and on any topic, depending on their research interests. One key factor for a competitive era is the variety of its closely interlinked, highly effective and autonomous national research and funding systems. And these are particularly successful when they coexist with the EU framework programs. Not only are the national funding organizations in close contact with their scientific communities, enabling them to respond directly to the needs of knowledge-driven research, the distinct national systems of research and funding also give rise to highly versatile research that we need to consolidate and promote. Close cooperation strengthens the individual countries involved, particularly widening countries, and thereby Europe as a whole. Indeed, the era's great institutional variety provides a fertile environment for truly wide-ranging gains in knowledge made in Europe. The second factor that characterizes the era is bilateral and multilateral cooperation. This is what enables the DFG, together with its partner organizations, to provide tailor-made cross-border funding opportunities that meet the needs of the researchers. The crucial importance of such funding schemes is demonstrated by the high level of demand among researchers for easily accessible bilateral funding programs. For this reason, the DFG's funding portfolio provides numerous opportunities for cooperation with European partners across disciplines and topics at any time. With the aim of expanding these funding opportunities in line with demand in the scientific community, we have recently concluded several bilateral memoranda of understanding with partner organizations in Israel, in Norway, in Switzerland, and the United Kingdom, as well, of course, as also in Asia and the Americas. The most prominent example of bilateral and trilateral cooperation is certainly the very successful WEAVE initiative. This currently enables researchers to submit joint proposals with one or two European partners at any time and on any topic, which they then are handled by one of the partner organizations. This requires trust in each other and in the quality of the respective processes. The DFG is open to further expanding the WEAVE initiative wherever quality allows, as it brings us closer to our common goal in Europe to enable borderless cooperation. The DFG, moreover, strives for an era that offers its broad institutional spectrum the world's best framework conditions for research. Yet the way in which research can be conducted depends not only on funding structures, but also on the legal and scientific framework conditions. This is why we are very grateful, both to national and European policy makers, for their willingness to engage in constant, trusting dialogue, and for their openness towards the efforts of scientific communities and funding organizations in shaping an era that is well suited to pioneering cutting-edge research. To shape the framework conditions for research cooperation in Europe, we actively contribute to Science Europe and support initiatives such as the Coalition for Advancing Research Assessment and the European Open Science Cloud. We are also increasingly contributing to EU legislative processes relevant to research, such as animal welfare or the use of new breeding methods. Jointly developing coherent standards, criteria, and procedures enables us to facilitate knowledge-driven research of the highest quality within the era. Nowadays, these framework conditions definitely include research security and exercising particular caution when considering cooperation with certain partners. Unfortunately, I would like to say. Like many partner organizations, the DFG has issued guidelines on how to de-risk research cooperation, providing guidance and support for researchers and reviewers. If we agree on common value-based guidelines founded on the principle of responsible openness, and if we harness science diplomacy to build bridges and open windows of opportunity, the benefits of cooperation will outweigh the risks for research and society, even in a changing and a challenging geopolitical landscape. Complementing strong national research systems and multilateral cooperation in Europe, the European funding programs, notably the EU framework programs, are the third factor that determine the era. The DFG is particularly dedicated to ensuring that the interests of the scientific community are adequately reflected in these programs, namely the objective of strengthening independent research of the highest quality. In the negotiations for the upcoming EU framework program, the DFG is therefore advocating better opportunities for additional funding of basic research collaborations. There is a particular need for transnational research consortia on self-chosen topics and for EU co-funding of transnational calls of national research funding organizations, two new instruments that would further facilitate the free movement of researchers, of knowledge and innovation across Europe. So the interplay of these three aforementioned factors results in a unique, I would like to say, wealth of institutions and fields of research. In this European research area, researchers from the most diverse cultural and social backgrounds can freely pursue their scientific curiosity, conducting outstanding basic research in close cooperation with international partners. The rich variety of their findings and innovations is our capital for the future and vital to the global success of cutting-edge research, both made in Germany and pursued jointly in Europe. Adequately promoting this variety requires a broad range of funding programs, both at national and multilateral level throughout Europe, and complemented by the EU framework programs. Whether at European or global level, the basis for fruitful multilateral research funding is provided by strong national research systems with independent research institutions and funding organizations. So, moving now on to our panel discussion, please join me again in welcoming our moderator. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Professor Becker, for this very clear perspective on how the DFG sees European cooperation in the future and the future of ERA. I also found it interesting that you reminded us to enable borderless cooperation is really one of the key common goals we all have in Europe. I think that's, we have to keep that in mind always. We are now really looking forward to welcome the other guests. I would ask you to take the seat to the right. And this gives me the opportunity to introduce the other three panelists whose name were already mentioned. Please join us up here on the stage, Professor Krzysztof Joszwiak from Poland. Please come up here and take the seat next. Professor Dame Ottolin Leiser, we have the middle seat for you. Please join us here. And Professor Walter Rosenthal, please come up here as well. And as soon as we are all seated, I will say a couple of words to each of you, of course. Krzysztof Joszwiak is the director of the National Science Center in Poland. NCN is the abbreviation. He's a chemist by training, made his PhD in Lublin in Poland. At the Medical University, where he today is a professor at the Faculty of Pharmacy. The National Science Center in Poland was established in 2011. It's Poland's major funding agency for basic research, if I'm right. Budget of around 300 million euros per year, more or less. Correct me if I'm wrong. And it already has many joint initiatives with DFG, and we'll come to some of those later. Welcome, Professor Joszwiak. It's great to have you here. Professor Dame Ottolin Leiser is the Chief Executive of UKRI, which is UK Research and Innovation. She's made a PhD in genetics in 1990, University of Cambridge. She became Professor for Plant Development at Sainsbury Lab at the very same university in 2011, and she's now the Director of the Sainsbury Lab there. In 2000... Corrections are allowed.
Not since I've been doing this job.
Okay, okay. Where? But this one is right and definitely correct. 2017, she was knighted and became Dame Commander of the Order of the British Empire for her services to science and society. And UK Research and Innovation, the organization, she's Chief Executive Officer, is an umbrella organization of all the 9 British research councils, basically. It describes itself in its annual report as the engine for the UK as a powerhouse for research and innovation. I think that's a decent statement. Annual budget, roughly 9 billion euros, 3.5 for basic research, which is more or less on par with what the DFG has. Also, the UKRI has many joint initiatives with the DFG already. Welcome. Professor Dame Ottolin Leiser, it's great to have you here, and we're curious what you have. Walter Rosenthal is the president of the German Rectors Conference, HRK in German, which represents the interests of basically all the German universities and gives them one voice. He's a medical doctor by training, who then turned to pharmacy, quite pharmacology, more correctly.
Difference.
Big difference, pharmacology, I apologize, because very successfully he turned to pharmacology. He was, among others, director of the Leibniz Institute for Molecular Pharmacology in Berlin. He was chair of the board and scientific director of the Max Delbrück Center in Berlin. He was president of the Friedrich Schiller University in Jena from 2014 to 2023. And the German Rectors Conference, he's now presiding, supports many German universities in many ways in their efforts to become even more international. It's great to have you here, Professor Rosenthal. Professor Joszwiak, the first question goes to you. During the last decades, Poland's National Science Center has really considerably extended its ties to international partners, especially also to Germany, in the framework of the bilateral cooperation within the WEAV initiative, mm-hmm. we've already heard of. WEAV enables very simple cooperation with partners from up to 3 European countries and is aimed in reducing bureaucracy, which Staatsminister Professor Blume should appreciate probably. So given all this experience in cooperation projects within European research frameworks, what are the benefits you see for bi- and multilateral research cooperations for different actors, especially in Poland? If you look at universities, research organizations, what are the benefits and how do you in Poland intend to further push international cooperation in the future?
Yes, indeed. National Science Center is an organization involved in plenty of different initiatives, bilateral, multilateral. We are very happy to develop them, and we really can see growing interest of Polish scientists working in Poland to be involved in those initiatives, to fund the research in an international collaboration and cooperation manner. So we can really see, first of all, we can really see the growing number of researchers, growing number of consortia which are involved in this, which is obviously very important from the point of view of developing the excellence of science and developing the open research which is performed on an excellent level on the most interesting, broad and complete topics. So indeed, we are a partner in WEAVE. We have, I think, a growing partner in this WEAVE initiative. We really can see a growing number of researchers who are involved in proposals, who are involved in winning the grants, and very frequently they are involved as leaders of international consortia to run these projects. I think I can say something from the point of view of or from the Polish perspective, which is a perspective of the so-called widening country. So indeed, we started the running research in really open and international manner not so long ago, which is indeed a challenge at the very beginning, but as soon as we opened the opportunity for the researchers to apply and to run projects in the and to fund projects in the international bilateral and multilateral systems, we could very quickly see the that a lot of researchers get involved into that. We have a growing number of really research groups which are internationally recognized, internationally cooperative and internationally competitive. And that's, if I can recall to what Professor Becker said, this is indeed what we can do. Our job is to develop the strong national research system to allow scientists and to encourage scientists to be involved in the international collaboration, international projects, and to be just, you know, a part of worldwide running science.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. Yeah, and what you said is we come to back to that later. So cooperation is like fueling excellence, basically, right? That's mm-hmm. the experience from Poland. That's maybe yes. something we come back later a little bit to. I'd like to first hand over to Professor Dame Ottolin Leiser. Since January 2024, the UK is finally back in Horizon Europe as an associate member of the framework program. So the European Union's 95 billion framework program, which is a big program for research and innovation. I know from
from interviews I've made with people in Great Britain that many researchers were longing for this moment for quite a while, because it gives them now much, much easier access to money from Brussels again. What are the main reasons for the reassociation from your point of view, so that it happened now? And which implications does it actually have for UKRI's bi- and multilateral cooperation schemes?
Thank you. I think I'm going to start zooming out massively, which is perhaps a slight stretch of your question, but I think it's important. We're living in a very difficult time. Globally, there are a lot of challenges, climate change, we've just been through an economic crisis and then a pandemic. And that kind of anxiety and the inequalities that have gone with that, I think, have allowed people who want to drive division. And a lot of what we're seeing in within nations, between nations globally, is the manifestation of that polarized division, which is really a challenge for all of us. I think research and innovation are extraordinarily powerful in tackling that. They're fundamentally about hope. They're about the ability, if we work together, to address these challenges in all kinds of ways. And they are about agency. They are about taking people out of a position where they feel both helpless but also disempowered, and giving people, if we work together, that power to tackle these kinds of challenges. That's a very kind of grandiose statement, but it's also something I believe very passionately, and actually I think is demonstrably true. So I think research and innovation are a key tool in the world as we tackle the challenges that we're facing together. And in that context, of course, international collaboration in research and innovation is a critical part, precisely transcending all of those borders, all of those boundaries that are currently separating us and keeping us apart. So as well as the sort of bottom-up drive where individual researchers are striving for excellence, want to proceed as quickly as they can to collaborate with the best people in the world, to access the best equipment, all of that bottom-up drive is entirely concordant with the extraordinary opportunity to use all of that creativity to reshape our world for the better and to build that more collaborative world with social cohesion at the core. And that's, I think, our opportunity. And as funding agencies, we kind of sit in between those things. We sit in between the political drivers for supporting research and innovation that are, of course, about economic growth and excellence in public services and providing prosperity to nations, but also about tackling global challenges that we need to work together to do. So all of that. And then on the other side, the research community, wonderful people motivated by the excitement of their field, wanting to discover new things, wanting that to be useful in the world in an integrated way. So that's our chance. And I think the Horizon Europe program and those framework programs in general are fantastic example of the combination of those things, bringing together countries, bringing together extraordinary talent from across Europe to create easy opportunities to work together to solve those kinds of problems. So of course it's rather important, I think, for the UK to be part of that, to be able to contribute. And I'm incredibly excited that we have finally got over the hurdle of being able to associate. And I'm also really pleased that UKRI has been able to help that process. So the UK government throughout actually has provided a guarantee stream of funding so that researchers applying to Horizon Europe, whilst we were not associated, were still able to apply. And were they successful, there was an alternative funding source that we've channeled through to support that. So I hope that that's allowed the momentum, although undoubtedly slowed by the hiatus, to be rapidly rebuilt so that we can be a really fully participating member. It's very exciting.
Thank you very much. We'll dig a little deeper in a couple of minutes how future cooperation schemes could look like. Let's shift to Professor Rosenthal. Professor Rosenthal, in Germany, we've seen a very huge tendency towards internationalization, if you look at universities, within the last 10 to 15 years. I've read that we've currently around 370,000 foreign students from abroad at German universities. So at universities, they already amount to 15% of all the students, which is not as good as in Great Britain, of course, but try to get up. We're even among the top four host countries, meanwhile, I think directly after Great Britain now, for foreign students to come and get direct education, basically. So obviously, things have been moving quite a bit. What role does the German Rectors Conference, whose president you are, play in bringing all this about? So what activities are you pursuing with respect to Europe, and how do you support universities to become even more international in the future in Germany?
Well, I think that science is in a traditional situation. You mentioned it today, the scientific community, and that's why we need the international collaboration basically on all levels. And well, the HIK is supports internationalization, of course, but I would clearly state that it's at the level of the individual institution, the individual university. That's where international research, international teaching, and so on is clearly promoted, and we as HIK try to support it. I would like to emphasize that the European framework is very important for our universities, and I think for the entire scientific community. The important point is that the European area represents a shared space for our core values, academic freedom, institutional autonomy, and liberal democracy. And you know that they are not undisputed today. So I think it's very important that we have this European framework because of these challenges. And I think that the importance of the cooperation across Europe and beyond cannot be overstated. And the university, the German university, but also the other non-university institutions, they are informed by these values. They are based on these values. The idea of a free and democratic Europe is one of the cornerstones on which our national science system rests. And it's safe to say that without this larger European frame, science and research in Germany would look different and would be worse off. The framework program for research also drives internationalization of German universities. It transforms them into true European institutions, and on a different level, it also serves as an element for quality assurance. Academic cooperation across Europe is its many-fold forms, from recently founded European University Alliance to long-established student exchange programs, which you mentioned, and from shared large-scale research infrastructure to single EU research projects, brings the concept of Europe to our universities here in Germany. And conversely, by participating in these programs, our universities also actively shape Europe and bring their own values and ideas to the larger European table. On a more worldly level, Europe has become an important source of third-party funding for our universities. The figure was mentioned this morning, I think, that 10% of the third-party funding at universities is European money. So it's very important, and the universities simply could not live without it. Major funding agencies, the DFG, of course, and also the BMBF, we saw the figures this morning too, 30%, around about 30% each institution. And I think that this European funding is also important for the prestige and the international visibility of our universities. I would like to mention briefly the European Research Council. It has become an important benchmark for cutting-edge research. Around two-thirds of the ERC grants awarded to Germany over the past 10 years have gone to outstanding researchers at universities. It's of crucial importance to HRK and its member institutions that ERC remains the institution that prioritizes the generation of new knowledge in an open topic and excellence-based manner. Only this approach ensures that Europe will continue to lead in global innovation by exploring original ideas and setting new research trends. And finally, I strongly believe that it's imperative to safeguard the principles of excellence as the core criterion for funding decisions in European research programs. Only this principle ensures that funding is allocated to the most promising and high-quality research projects, thereby enabling and fostering an environment of competitiveness and innovation which allows European research to thrive. Securing excellence and competitiveness in the European research area is in turn also the basis for ensuring that European science remains an attractive partner for scientific cooperation on a global scale.
Thank you very much, Professor Rosenthal. I think for the rest of this discussion, we'll skip the larger European part a little bit and look at the bilateral and multilateral cooperations. Although ERC, without any doubt, is a very, very genius European invention, I think so. We'll all agree on that. But I would like to come back to Professor Becker, because you were mentioning in your talk, so in addition to the European framework programs and all the things which are derived from that, like ERC, it's really important that we have these strong national innovation systems and we have strong and very intricate ties between those. Can you elaborate a little bit more on how DFG is approaching this? Because I've realized when preparing for this event that there's a whole bunch of different things already up and running. Many people are maybe not even familiar with. So could you tell us a bit more about what is your vision about this bi- and multilateral corporations?
Thank you very much. So I would like to say when the DFG enters or thinks about entering a bio-multilateral collaboration, the guiding principle, or maybe the guiding star, so to say, is really the research interest of the scientists themselves. So if there is the demand from the scientific community and there are people, you know, standing up and saying, you know, we want to collaborate with this and that country, maybe on this or that topic, this is something the DFG, of course, would react to. And then when we get into contact with other countries, other organizations, we always have to take into account that the framework conditions that have been mentioned previously, they can considerably differ between different countries. So what we usually do is then sit together and compare the framework conditions in the different countries and then see how we can best match them, how we can bring them together. And then I would like to say the first level often is a thematic call in a certain scientific area, you know, kind of explorative call on a certain topic to see how great the interest is and how the procedures actually work. The next level would then maybe be an open call, which of course the DFG favors very much, and there are some countries and also governments that have to be convinced that this is something good to do, and maybe even standing open calls. And the probably highest level are then lead agency procedures such in WEAVE, which make the procedure of collaboration and also research funding much more easy, but also involve a lot of trust, in the quality of what the partners do. And next to these aspects, of course, we also have, I would like to say, individual collaborations with each country, like with UK, UKRI, and Ottoline, of course. We have wonderful colleagues there. We have a long-standing tradition, I would like to say, a couple of hundred years of collaboration in research between UK and Germany, of course. And this is something we never want to lose. So we are so happy that we have these fantastic colleagues again in the European research area. Ottoline and myself just about a year ago signed an agreement on data sharing, which now can be used by all the councils of UKRI, and which will make it much more easy also, you know, to get the other contracts and collaborations running. And Ottoline, Liza and myself, it has been mentioned before, are also very active together in bodies such as Science Europe or also the Global Research Council, where we try to, I would like to say, fight together for the same rights and the same ideas. So it's fantastic to have.
So these are advocacy groups where researchers utter their their interests and pursue them publicly. Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly. And maybe just to add that, so with our wonderful colleagues from Poland, of course, also there is a great tradition of cooperation and great trust. Here there are, several organizations, of course, NCN, but also FNP and also the Academy, and we all collaborate together. We have joint funding programs. We award the Copernicus Prize together. And we also have the Polish-German Science Meeting, where our colleagues just 2 weeks ago invited us to Warsaw, and we all met there to collaborate. So, and this is quite, individual than these relationships.
I'd like to pass ask the question to all of you. So could the WEAVE initiative and this lead agency principle, could that, if we look a little bit in the future, be served like as a template for future, for many more future corporations within Europe? So, because obviously it was very difficult to get to that point because different agencies had to streamline their procedures and agree on mechanisms, criteria, and many things. So it was complicated, but was it worth it? And do you see it as a template? What would you say, Professor Jurschwiak?
Yeah.
That's good. Thanks. Yeah.
Yes, that's indeed true. Indeed, many different organizations, they have some different frameworks and details. Yeah. However, working in this type of format, we are more working also on a conformity, on the having those regulations as similar as possible, which is also very very important part. We really benefited a lot from cooperation with different organizations from different countries, and we also see a lot of benefits from applying this lead agencies procedures in WEAVE and in other programs. So we consider them very effective, and we would like to apply them also to some other multilateral and bilateral programs what we have at the moment. And they are not working on the lead agencies procedures framework yet.
What about UKRA, Professor Leiser? Are you also thinking of it? I think there are already some corporations in the same context. Could you think of making this become bigger, or do you have other preferences concerning promoting?
Yeah, we have a wide range of instruments for international collaboration, and I think this issue of diversity is actually quite important because there are different reasons for international collaborations at different times with different partners, and ensuring you have the range of tools you need to support those is key. So, for example, we have the opportunity or a kind of embedded mechanism now right across the organization whereby any applicant for a grant can bring on board a colleague from another country as part of that. And up to 30% of the funding can go directly to the person in the other country. So that's perhaps the lowest effort way to build a collaboration with somebody in another country. Mm-hmm. And that tool is available to the various funding parts of the organization when they want to use it. And then we have lead agency arrangements and MOUs and a whole variety of things to allow us to build the bilateral and trilateral partnerships that we want to. And then actually, as I said at the beginning, because there is a straightforward political dimension to international science collaboration as part of the kind of wider diplomatic agenda, we also administer funds that are given to us directly by government to build collaborations with particular partners. And so again, you wind up with this kind of layered bottom-up, top-down set of tools that help you to navigate the landscape and hopefully drive both the best science we can, but also the best collaboration and the best taking down of those borders that we're also keen to melt away.
So the basic idea is to make access to cross-border cooperation projects as low level as possible. And Professor Rosenthal, do universities experience this like this? Do they know from about all these opportunities, or is it maybe sometimes also a bit obscure where to apply for what type of project funding? What is your experience?
I think that the universities knows about the options they have. The HRK itself is not a funding agency, unfortunately. Maybe that will change, but so we cannot provide money for international collaboration. But of course, the programs of the DFG and other research organizations are well known, and also on the European level. What I quite often experience and hear from our from the universities is that it's complicated to apply for a project. An international project, because the money usually cannot be transferred in another country. You mentioned that you can do that to a certain extent. And we in Germany, we have a few exceptions where it's possible. Ukraine, Israel is an excellent example. So I think we need more of that we have programs established by two countries. So we need a framework between two countries, for example, and then you can apply for funding. And it should not be too bureaucratic, and it should be only one review process and probably not two, as it's sometimes the case. So one should make it easy, the threshold low, to support really international research by combining forces between two research organizations of different countries.
Mm-hmm. Now, I also know that DFG already has a couple of those programs in line as well, so there's already a lot of possibilities. Let's briefly shift to another issue, which was also mentioned in the introductory talks. Let's look at the geopolitical changements we've seen within the last years. In Germany, for instance, but also in the UK, I think all scientific collaborations with Russian institutions were stopped after Russia's invasion in Ukraine. And the government's new China strategy also forces researchers to think more in detail about with whom to cooperate and what type of project partners to choose. What for your organization, where your experience with these geopolitical changes we see, so how has it affected your doing, actually? Do you want to start?
Yes, this is obviously a very important concern, and we also applied, we also have similar rules regulating cooperation with Russia, for example, and so on. Indeed, this is a raising concern because of many reasons, and we already mentioned it. It's, the world becomes more and more, less and less open,
yeah,
that way, which is obviously we need to take into consideration. So indeed, we are not discouraging the scientists to cooperate with researchers from other countries, but rather we are trying to, pinpoint some potential risks associated with this, define this risk, and we are applying some rules and regulations which might allow to lower those risks in the future. So I think this is the way what our organization is dealing with those problems now.
That's a little bit in line with what the European Commission also wants researchers to do. It's advocating value-based research partnerships where you cooperate with people who share more or less the same, yeah, values or ideas. Mm-hmm. Is that something all the UKRA is pushing? And how do you do it, actually? How do you have concrete measures to make sure that scientists stick to it?
Yeah, so, I mean, this is obviously a huge issue globally, and I think many nations are working on a as open as possible, but as secure as necessary type framework.
So it's a balancing question, right?
Yeah. Absolutely, and then you need to support your research community to navigate what that means. And so we're interested in proportionate risk-based measures. We have comparatively little kind of windows of control. Obviously, there's the point at which we issue funding, and we can ask our referees to contribute to that question about the risks associated with any particular project, and the collaborators named on the project. But of course, we know that the moment you issue the grant is not the end of the story, and it's a very global community. You meet someone at a conference, and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. So a lot of what we need to do is to drive up awareness in the research and innovation community more generally, shift culture to ensure that people are absolutely aware of the risks, that they have tools and resources available to help them to navigate those. There's a dedicated agency set up now inside the department, just Department for Science, Innovation and Technology, that supports innovation, supports universities in assessing those risks. So a number of things have gone in place, but it will be a question really of culture change to support proportionate navigation of the risks whilst, as we have said, all of us capturing as far as possible the benefits of openness, which are so important, particularly in addressing those conflicts that we face in the first place. So really tricky for everybody. I think there really is a changing tide in how researchers are engaging with that agenda, and funding agencies, but also governments, I think, have a really key role in helping that to reach that goal of as open as possible, but secure as necessary.
Professor Becker, what is the DFG's approach to that, and how does it fit to the international discussions at the Global Research Council, where you were also chairman of the Board of Governors until last year, I think, so you're familiar with all the international discussions. So do our ways of dealing with these problems, with geophysical changements and scientific security, are they reflected somehow on the international level?
Yeah, absolutely. So very much in line with what Ottolien actually says, this is exactly what we are also proposing from the side of the DFG, and I think we really share that with many science funding organizations and also research performing organizations. So there are risks, definitely, and I think we have been aware of the risks all the time, but we are getting more and more aware of them because also the geopolitical situation is changing. And we are in very close contact with all the relevant partners here. For me, it is very important that we establish also a European perspective on this topic. This will further bring together the European research area, and there are already processes going on. So I think it's very important that the different countries within Europe come together and really sit on one table and think about these topics, because that will help science and research a lot. And of course, scientists and research organizations would be very grateful or are depend on, of course, the information from politics and also from, let's say, for example, security services. But in the end, we propose that the decision should be science-led, because scientists exactly know with whom they want to carry out which project and which risk there is with respect to the partner. You know, with some input also from politics and security services, but particularly with respect to the project. So that is what we would propose.
Let's take we've talked a lot about what is currently being done, what needs to be done. Let's jump a little bit ahead. Let's look in the future for 10 years. So let's look at the year 2035. And if we think about research cooperation 10 years from now, what is your vision? What will it look like? Brief answer, if possible. Who wants to start?
Well, in 10 years from now, it would be the last year of the 10th framework in Europe. So I would hope that we have a good budget in the next framework. secondly, that we have a good mix of open topic research and mission-driven research. And third, I think it would be very important to strengthen certain fields like the social, the humanities and the social sciences. They do not play a prominent role right now, and I think it's very important in the future also to address our big challenges to strengthen their role in the future. So a couple of wishes I have for the future of the framework.
Okay, the next European framework program is supposed to start in 2028, right? And it's now being prepared. And scientists, of course, and funding organizations are trying to get their interests incorporated there as well.
Let me add one other point. Together with our Polish and French colleagues, we are trying to promote the idea of a European excellence initiative, not only for science, but also for the private sector. And I hope that we will be successful with this initiative.
Professor Dame Ottolin Leise, what is your vision for research cooperation in Europe 2035?
Well, I would very much share your view that the transformative power of research and innovation is critically dependent on it being fully embedded across our society. So it's not clever people over there doing it to you, it's by the people and for the people. And a move really to embed much more deeply the whole research and innovation endeavor societally, I think that's key. And then nobody yet has said AI. And I think it's not very difficult to think about research and innovation in 10 years' time without thinking about the transformation that we are anticipating will come from AI in what's possible, in how we do the work, in just altogether. And then, of course, we need to worry about data and compute. So I think those things will be foundational as we move forward in capturing the extraordinary benefits that I think can come from AI in the very human context of a societally embedded research and innovation system.
Well, AI could certainly help to reduce bureaucracy, I think, but of course we are looking at much more deeper revolutions in various fields concerning that, Professor Juszwiak, what is your vision 10 years from now?
Well, I can say that I totally agree with
Professor Rosenthal,
with what you've said before. Actually, I was also going to mention the AI as a really a revolution.
Which it's a game changer, right?
Which is coming. On the many different levels, also from the point of view of a research funding organization, it will surely revolutionize the procedures and all the frameworks what we are applying at the moment. This is really something which is actually happening. We don't know yet the direction or the, you know, the final goal of that, but indeed this is happening and we need to have the good procedures and the good strategies to deal with that. I believe in science. If you ask me in general, I believe in science and I believe that the science will be more and more open and more addressing really fundamental questions for our society.
Thank you very much. Professor Becker, your vision 10 years from now, what do you think?
Yeah, so very much along these lines, I also think science and research are absolutely essential to be able to solve or at least tackle the problems we have on this planet. Second, as Walter Rosenthal mentioned, I always hate talking about money, but if we want the European research area to remain competitive in the global context, if you think of all the other countries and continents coming up at the moment, then definitely this will not be possible without budget. I dream of a European research area in which each partner has his and her place, in which we can really cooperate freely, openly, in which also young people can exchange freely, be very mobile, and in which each partner can bring in his and her strength. Because many countries, you know, they have certain strength, they have infrastructures, they have particular interests in certain research areas, also historically, or they have certain let's say, geographical conditions, which they can also bring in. So, yeah, that would be my vision.
Thank you very much, Professor Becker. As we're approaching the end of our discussion, let me try to summarize some of the key points, maybe, or at least some of the things I take away. Well, we all agreed that the European research area really relies on a strong national research system. I think that's completely undoubted here. But in addition, it also needs bi- and multilateral cooperation schemes to bring people together across borders. We've also learned that there exist already many of these funding opportunities which are already in place and which allow universities and research organizations to benefit from sort of custom-tailored funding opportunities to pursue their scientific interests. Also funding schemes that can complement European funding within the framework program, basically. And we've also realized that many urgent problems like geopolitical developments and also security issues, but also the big global questions like climate change, biodiversity crisis can certainly only be addressed if scientists join forces and make themselves heard in all these different and important organizations which take the decisions in Brussels or elsewhere. And it's probably wise to join forces and take more joint activities in that sense. Stronger together, that was the motto of our discussion, and it turns out that even it could serve as a motto for future joint undertakings in advancing science within Europe through more corporations. And I think we're all in charge to make this vision become a reality. Thank you very much to our panelists for sharing your insights, expertise, and visions with us. It was a pleasure talking to you. And I would say, please, let's give them one final roaring applause.
Llega la lluvia para limpiar las heridas. A veces solo una gota puede vencer la sequía. ¿Y para qué llorar? ¿Para qué? Si duele una pena, sordida. Para encontrar el camino. ¿Y para qué llorar? ¿Para qué? Si duele una pena, se olvida. ¿Y para qué sufrir? ¿Para qué? Si así es la vida, que vivirla. Voy a leer. Voy a gozar.
Messiah.
Thank you.